Hello and welcome to this Fireside Chat. I'm Florian Böhme, the Global Account Director for SAP here at Amazon Web Services. Today, I have the pleasure to talk to Philipp Herzig, one of the executives from SAP. Glad you're here.
So excited to be here with you together on AWS reInvent. The pleasure is all mine. We are harmonizing and simplifying the end-to-end experience of SAP across the entire application portfolio, top to bottom, from the user experience down to cloud operations and delivery. But also in the middle, we have something to do, and that's the topic for today, generative AI, which we're infusing across all of our business applications. There are so many use cases. First of all, in the application space, along all the end-to-end processes, take lead to cash, right? From marketing, commerce, to sales, maybe services, depending on the industry that you're in HR, in finance, to supply chain, but also in procurement and spend management. We're working and realizing many, many use cases, such as, for example, with SAP Concur, our travel and expense management solution, more than 45,000 customers around the globe, including AWS, which we're very happy about. And there are use cases like, how can we make travel planning, for example, much easier instead of, you know, tedious travel planning, which takes a lot of time. Just imagine you could type into Concur, I want to go to AWS reInvent from Monday to Friday. Maybe you give it the class of the hotel that you want to stay whatsoever, some boundary conditions, and then figure it all out by its own, and maybe some alternative plans and so on. And this is what large language models, generative AI, can help. But it's not only the planning, but it's also what happens after the travel. You come back, right, with all your receipts and your hotel bill and much more. And generative AI can help with natural language understanding these documents and help with the itemization, for example, which is usually very tedious and painful with all the various taxations and everything, all the rules you need to adhere to. And generative AI can help with that a lot. Plus, of course, in all the various languages, which is super powerful. We are very excited about this. And it's just one, right, of the many use cases that are either already realized or working on. And then, of course, the other thing that we are very excited about is we have announced at SAP Tech, at our technology event, we announced something that we call the Generative AI Hub. And after integrating all our SAP business applications with this Generative AI Hub, also customers ask, oh, how can I do the same? And to build, for example, an extension as part of SAP S/4HANA or SAP SuccessFactors, because it's so nicely integrated. And then, of course, they can leverage also Amazon Bedrock as part of this, which I think we're going to speak about in a minute, to really make this integration very seamless and leverage the power of Amazon Bedrock with the large language models in conjunction with our SAP business applications.
So I'm incredibly happy that you're talking about improvements to SAP Concur, because we are also using it, and I am having it on my mobile app, obviously. So anything that will help you improve the
absolutely
experience of invoicing hotels or so would be awesome. Now, you talked about using Amazon Bedrock in that specific SAP Concur use case. What led you to choose AWS to support your engineers developing that and innovating?
So first of all, we have a great partnership since 2008, right? So AWS was really the first infrastructure provider to host some of our largest instances, right, in the cloud when it comes to ERP, for example. And of course, obviously, as part of, and we collaborate on many, many aspects, right, between SAP and AWS. And so it was just a natural way also to obviously evaluate and look into Bedrock, right, and use the flexibility, the various models that you provide, for example, through Bedrock, with the scale, and of course also with the enterprise readiness features. Think of FedRAMP, EU access compliance, and all those things which really matter, right, if you address a large market as we do, right, together for our joint customers. And, you know, those things naturally was a way to look into this, but of course also the models you host, of course, also a differentiator. The Titan model, and also if you look at the keynote, right, of Swami, of Adam, right, you're going to see more of what's coming out there as well as Anthropic, Cohere, and obviously these models together, of course, with the footprint we have already on AWS, such as Concur itself, obviously made a lot of sense to bring this together.
And can you, Philipp, share a little bit the experience about how the teams were actually working with these models from Amazon in that specific use case?
Yeah, so we started off, right, with, first of all, looking at the use case, but then also look at Bedrock and the various models and compared also these models. So which models would perform best, for example, for the certain use cases. And like many meanwhile realize, it's not like one model that fits all purposes, but there are trade-offs to consider also between the models. And Bedrock really helped, right, with evaluating and finding out what is the right model, but then also deploy it at scale, right, with the already mentioned enterprise qualities that our customers come to expect. And the experience was very, very good. And we are looking forward to continue working with Bedrock and bringing this together into our applications, but of course also with our generative AI hub to our joint customers and partners.
Right. Now, when you think about generative AI, I think data is key, right? You use data for everything, applications, business processes, business decision-making. Can you maybe start sharing a little bit with us what you do, what your building blocks are within your team to use data at the forefront of your decision-making?
Absolutely. And look, I think still, even with all the buzz, right, and all the greatness and this huge technology advancement that we're seeing with large language models or in general, foundational models, I still think that data is still the key differentiator. And this is also where I believe the true magic of what we call SAP Business AI lies, which is combining the data that is stored already on our customers' most precious data, bring this together with the best of the large language models to create something unique, right, that is hard to do otherwise. And of course, then also in a data privacy preserving, secure fashion that, again, our customers simply come to expect because they trust SAP with their data, and that we are making sure that that all the qualities are falling into place. And because on one side, right, these large language models, for example, they hallucinate, mm-hmm. or they maybe have been trained up until a certain point, and for sure they don't know your real-time data that currently runs on the business. And I think bringing really this together to ground the large language models and the realities of the business through grounding, retrieval, augmented generation, or maybe fine-tuning, depending on the context of the application, that is really where we bring the data together. And then secondly, what we also do is, and that's also something that we are very proud of, because customers not only trust us today in the operations in the cloud with their data, but also more than 25,000 customers meanwhile have given us consent to also use this data to train with AI new models. And what we also set forth is to create an own foundational model based on the SAP data that customers were willing to share with us. And we are creating that and doing still some research development while we speak. But this is then also a model where we believe that helps businesses to make better recommendations, better predictions for businesses overall.
Oh, then our customers are trying to figure out how they best use those models. You talked about training those models, fine-tuning those models. We also have the inference and training processors at Amazon. Can you maybe explain in the context what that they could do, what they did for you in the context of helping, you know, for more specific use cases that customers have a more suitable large language model adopted to their specific needs, so to speak?
Yep. And it's a great question. I think the Trainium instances, right, on EC2 are really a leapfrog, right, in terms of scalability and performance, but also costs overall. So what we did a POC, right, your engineering teams, our engineering teams together, and compared this also with the so far, right, cutting edge with the P4DE instances. And we just found, right, that something that would require us for, I think, 23 days to train or fine-tune a model on AWS, we can now do just in 2 days at the same amount of epochs in order to train and fine-tune that model. And that's obviously a huge game changer, right? And the turnaround times and experimentation and trying to really come up with a model that suits the respective use case. So yeah, it's a great progress that you've been making. We're very excited about.
Cool. Now, when we talk about data, obviously large enterprises, they had collected data for so many years, but also it's important to keep safety and security of their data for the enterprises. And if you train those models, you want to make sure that this is top priority for your enterprise customers. How do you deal, you know, with privacy from an SAP point of view?
So first and foremost, right, I talked about this already a couple of times now, is that we take this from the get-go into our processes and the way how we architect it. So first of all, it's very important to state that just for the normal generative AI use cases at runtime, we are not fine-tuning or changing the models or that they even leave, right, the universe of the company, so to speak. So when techniques like retrieval augmented generation, prompt engineering, in-context learning, and so on are used, we, of course, partner with AWS to make sure, right, that these prompts are not stored and that the data is not used for fine-tuning and they're not unintentionally leak, so to speak, because this is something that customers are usually very concerned about. What we're going to do there is, again, on our business technology platform, to then anonymize and mask the data before it's, for example, sent to a large language model, that we are making sure is part of our data privacy rules that SAP has and their product standards are adhering, right, to all the various audits and certifications and so on that are in place. Again, customers simply expect this from us. On the other side, of course, is if customers intentionally to choose with their own data to fine-tune a model and so on, we, of course, have other mechanisms then in place. So by default, right, it's secure by default, it's anonymized, and it's data privacy preserving by default, unless customers choose to do so and then use the various techniques to fine-tune or train models on their own. But then always in the context, right, of their data, fully under their controllership.
Now, that data privacy is one thing, but when you think about the ethical point of view of generative AI, how do you embed that into your, you know, in applications that you're building? I think that's also something that our viewers.
It's a super important question, and it's also part of our SAP Business AI strategy that it's relevant, reliable, and responsible. And what does this mean? We already created, before even the whole AI or generative AI hype started, in 2018, we published our own AI ethics policy. You can find it on their sap.com, that basically states six core values, right, that we impose on ourselves on what's important to us when we talk about AI and either training models or just using them for inference. And that is, for example, that at the end of the day, there's always human oversight. Yeah. So we think really copilot is always the right word because we believe the AI is a friend at the side helping you, but you're still in the driver's seat, for example. We've got to make that sure. Bias and avoiding biases and discriminatory language. So we always consider those parts as well. And then, of course, transparency and explainability. So that even if there's a certain outcome, a certain proposal, that the user is capable of understanding where was this coming from? Why was this information created in the first place? And then we take these six values and we distributed them all along our development cycle. So from early ideation, right, down into running AI in operations and development and everything that comes in between, where from the very beginning up until the end, all these six values are always constantly, just with different methods, are ensured throughout the development cycle. And it also means sometimes, just to also make that proof point, it means sometimes that even early on already in the ideation stage, we're getting rid of certain ideas because they are not in compliance with the values that we've set forth for responsible AI. For example, in high risk areas such as HR, right, where it can be very easy to go into the, right, the complexities of biases, discriminating people, and so on. And we're avoiding that. And for this, for example, not only the policy, but for example, also a very stringent governance body, right, that. Where our legal folks, our data privacy colleagues, our diversity and inclusion officers, and many, many more people are there, where actually every of the Gen AI use cases are going through and are constantly monitored with respect to the outcome they are generating.
So basically that's employees at SAP that actually look at these use cases and judge from different business functions?
And judge from different business. I bet it's only one of the owner bodies, right? Yeah. And then there are more than also. Technology or tools, right, that you can use for anonymization. So it's really a tool set of various approaches on how we govern that. And then, of course, we're also participating in all the initiatives around the EU AI Act, the Bill of Rights executive order that was issued by Biden. And we are very active, right, also being and continues to be on the front of that because we really believe we don't want to wait for any regulations, but impose the highest standards on ourselves from the very beginning.
Oh, that's great to hear that you already had that since 2018 established, and great to hear that. Now, when you think about public sector customers, what is SAP doing to serve them? Do they have different needs in that space, or is it similar?
So public sector, of course, is very, very important from a compliance perspective, because everything we just talked about, right, you can't do it without. I think what comes in specifically in public sector, also in Europe, Germany specifically, is that we also partner there with other large language model companies that also try to find differentiation in that space. One of them is the startup, not sure if you heard of it, it's called Aleph Alpha. Mm-hmm. We are partnering with them and we are working really also then closely together with public sector
agencies, right? All the various offices, government, and so to really trying to find out how we can also serve public sector. So like in every regulated industry, all the things we just talked about are very, very critical and important.
Yeah, you've heard we announced together the European Sovereign Cloud as well. So I think we as a companies we will work together as well.
That is a standard
for our public sector industries. Right. Now, many viewers that might think about, okay, this is great. I want to be part of that journey with you, SAP, and us on using generative AI. They have services from you running. They're working to maybe use cases. What is your take? What would you advise customers that are on their journey? Using SAP services, maybe supported and extended by Amazon Bedrock. What is your advice to those customers in terms of innovation?
Yeah, first and foremost, I think customers should go to sap.com/AI to first figure out what we have in store already today, which is quite a lot, and way more to come also, still this quarter and in the next year. So that's the first place to, first of all, consider what's already there. If it's not there, right, you can then, of course, go through customer influence channels and proposals or reach out to SAP for ideas not yet on the roadmap, right, or in the product as it relates to, let's say, everything we are baking into our cloud applications into the standard. I think specifically also on AWS together with SAP, I think it's for us critically important that customers look also the new capabilities we expose on the SAP Business Technology Platform. Because again, this is like where customers in an SAP context would turn to figure out, okay, I have maybe an SAP S/4HANA application running or an SAP SuccessFactors application, but I have an idea that I want to realize now. How can I do this very quickly? And then, of course, there you can leverage the BTP runs on AWS, right? You can select AWS Bedrock and then work with Bedrock right in the context and including all the qualities that we just talked about in order to realize your own cases. And we also, for partners, for example, we offer so-called hack to build weeks and many other things, many offerings that are out there in order to engage and build things, right, jointly with SAP and AWS.
Great. And when we look maybe at the future, what can SAP and AWS do to help customers innovate and transform their business?
I think we are just getting started, right? And in my mind, we're just day one. I mean, for AWS, it's always day one, right? But in particular, in the generative AI, it's day one. And I think we are just getting started, right? And I think as many customers currently make up their mind, right, where most of the value is added, because we see many customers running one or even multiple initiatives around what they can do with it. And I think as it relates to, fine-tuning training models, specifically also for an industry, for example, I see a lot of potential. Of course, realizing all the various use cases in the next year, and then, of course, reaping a lot of benefits from generative AI in the enterprise. I think this is something that I'm really excited about and looking forward to work with you and our customers together realizing that.
And in many other examples, we have JRA, so joint reference architectures. Is that something that you will see coming along quite soon?
Very good that you mentioned it. Absolutely. I mean, we have anyway our joint reference architecture, right? SAP on AWS for RISE, for example. And yeah, we are also expanding that, right, for generative AI, so that people, like, how does SAP Business Technology Platform in AWS come together? What are the best practices, right? What is a compliant architecture? Those are the things, absolutely, that we continue to work on, update, right, and progress as we speak.
Great. Well, Philip, I think we could talk for hours, but thank you very much for that fireside chat. Really appreciate talking to you.
Absolutely. Pleasure is all mine, and I really enjoyed the conversation. Thank you so much for having me.